Hey guys, it's Katie. So I want to try making a pendant, or I'm going to try something first. I again don't know if it's going to work like 90% of my things I do, but I'm going to try it. So right now I have some scrap, kind of grayish, kind of have a mauve undertone to it. In real life, it's definitely got more of a gray brown. So I'm going to roll this out of my thickest setting. I was just rolling it by hand because it was too thick, but you see, I just had it folded up. So I started from the center and worked the ends to try to prevent air bubbles. And if you see air bubbles in your scrap clay or any clay while you're starting with it, immediately get those out of there. Just slice across them and just while you're conditioning it, because I still need to condition this. But if you see them, it's just good practice to try to work them out. And this is scrap, so I tend to get air bubbles in my scrap just because when you're working on a piece, you just throw them all in a pile and you don't really care at the moment to keep it all nice and pretty. So with this one, we're gonna do something here. And I'm gonna cut like a square out of it, kind of. Like this. Okay, and then I'm gonna roll out some white on my thickest setting as well and get that. And again, they're not really conditioned, it doesn't really matter at the moment. But I'm gonna get some white cut out into the same shape. And it doesn't have to be the purest white ever. It doesn't, because we're gonna be mixing this in a second. So just get some white so you can. Maybe not. Okay, I have the white rolled out now. And so what I'm gonna do with this one is cut it in half. And let me see if I have enough to make that similar shape with this one. My fiance's working in the garage. Half of our basement is a walkout garage, and I just heard him pop the breaker, and he was like, "Really? You just popped the breaker?" Did you just pop the breaker? He did. I totally heard it go pop. Just need like a little piece here. Doesn't need to be perfect, just something to kind of fit on here. Oop, good enough. Okay, so they're roughly about the same size, right? Sorry, I stopped because I had to think about this for 2 seconds. So the way we're going to mix an even color tone, now you can just eyeball this. This is generally what I do is eyeball it, but I wanted to try to get it a little more precise this time. So we're going to mix color blends. So if you cut, you have a right angle here of two colors, and all you do is just cut strips out of this. And again, you could just mix a Skinner blend, but right, so this one's going to have a little white. So if you did smaller strips, it'd mix evenly, right? It'd be a lot of white with a little brown, a lot of brown with a little white. Okay, I'm going to keep them a little wider because maybe I only need three different tones. So I'm going to take this and mix it with this. I'm going to take this. This will be at like a half and half. Mix it with that. I'm going to take this and mix it with this, and that's an easy way to get three color tones. Okay, I'm also going to take one or a little bit of this and mix it with some silver. It doesn't really matter. I don't really want to change the color of it too much. I just want to put some silver in it so I have a little bit of mica in one of the layers. And when you see the final piece, you'll get what I'm trying to accomplish. Do I have any silver right close by me? I do not know. Where's my silver? Okay, I'll find my silver. Be right back. Here we go, I have some scrap silver. So those are my three mixes of that. So I just took a little piece and I have some scrap silver from those bowls I made a while back. So this isn't pure silver because when I made those bowls, I added some ultramarine blue, these bowls. So it's not 100% pure silver, but it's pretty close. So I'll take, let's see, maybe 50-50. Yep, it's got a triple bone. Maybe 50-50, something like that, and mix it in. Okay, so I'll mix up these three and this one, and then I'll be back to you. I have my three tones mixed up, but I think they're just on the lighter end for me. So you could have started off when you rolled out your white, rolled it out on a thinner sheet if you want it to be lighter. Or your dark color, roll it out on a thinner sheet instead of it all on a setting zero. So I'm going to add a little more of my dark color to it. So let's see. So I have a square like or a rectangle like this on zero. And I'm going to take maybe that much for the dark one, maybe that much for the middle one, maybe that much for the light one. Mix that in. You know, and the size of my thumb or my pinky or my pointer finger. And I'll mix those into it just to get it a little bit darker. Okay, so now we have all the colors. This is the dark, and this is the one with the silver, so very similar. And then these three, and this is my color that my scrap. And it is Primo, because I mainly work with Primo. It's just a Primo scrap. Okay, so the next thing we need to do is get these all to about even shape and size and thickness. So I'm going to start off by doing that. I'm going to kind of play with them through my pasta machine to get them about the same size. Rather than long rectangles, which you totally could do, I'm going to turn them more into squares just by folding in the ends and rolling them through and then folding and rolling. So I'm going to make them more of a square shape. But if you have big pieces, you could just cut out a square, but I don't. So I want to use as much of this as I can. Okay, so now that they're all fairly squared, a little air bubble down there, we're going to begin. And maybe I'll thin them a little bit because they're a little thick. No, we'll thin them in a second. We're going to begin by stacking them or making a simple like Makumegane design. And, you know, it doesn't need to be perfect. Some people cut perfect squares. It doesn't need to be. It can be just similar. I mean, if you want them perfect, if that makes you feel better to have them perfect squares, then go ahead and make them perfect. But when it comes to me and crafting, at least with clay, I like to be a little more relaxed about it. That's what makes it fun for me. And this one. So I'm just going dark to light, not a big deal. No, definitely did not go dark to light. Hang on. I put that one on the wrong end. Where's my flat cut? Way over here? Okay, well, that's gonna go over here now. So, I actually want this silvery one on the top, then the three that we mixed. So the one with the mica on the bottom, but I have no clue. We'll see how this works. Just gonna kind of push them together. And I'm going to roll them out because we're going to put them through our pasta machine. So I'll roll them out a little bit because that's four, right? I have four colors, four of the setting zero. So it's going to be a lot for your machine to take. You don't want to strain your gears. There's an air bubble I see forming right there. So I'm going to slice into it and kind of push the air out. And again, you're going to get more air bubbles with your scrap for sure. Now I think it's at a point where my pasta machine can handle it, so I'm going to roll it through once. Doesn't matter from what end to what end, just roll it through. Okay, and yes, I had a little piece of the other one on there. That will be fine. And then we'll cut it in half. Oh, hang on, my phone's about to die. Plug it in. So, cut it in half, roughly around there, and we're going to stack it. And again, if you don't like jaggedy edges, we'll make them straight. That's totally your call. We're going to run it through again. So now we're just always doubling and tripling our layers here. Maybe another time, let's see. And this end's getting really skinny, so I am gonna take that part off. That's how thick our layers are right now. Come on, go together like I want you to. And we're always putting, you know, we're laying it back on top of each other. So dark to light, not two lights to two lights or two darks to two darks. That will give you a thicker strip. If you want to do that, you can. But in this one, we're just going to be staggering the colors. And I'm going to run that through again. I do want to make them finer. So the more times you run it through, the finer it's going to get. Usually I tend to like it a little chunkier. Jackson. I think I'm going to run it from this end and make it longer. Here we go. So I think that's enough. So let me just cut these weird ends off here. I'm going to leave these side ones on so you can see how fine it is now compared to even what this was, what, twice, three times? Big difference. Okay. So now we'll just cut it probably in half. We want to cut it in thirds. Maybe just in half. Let me just fold it over, see where half is. You can do a ruler if you want. Oh, it was pretty good. Okay, and then we're going to stack these. See if I can get that to fit. Just by pulling it a little bit. There we go. And I think what I'm going to do next is cut this in four. Jacks. Yeah. And that way we have a little thick block. Look at all the fine layers we got in there. squish them together a little bit. And then we're just going to be using straight lines in this one. I want to just use straight lines. So I'm just going to use my blade. You can use also the back of your blade will be thicker than the knife edge. Stuff like this, like, or a credit card will give you thicker lines. So with this one, I'm just going to, and I'm doing it on an angle for me because it's just easier. I write sideways too. Using the back side of my blade right now. That will have more drag to it. You could also wrap your blade in some cardstock or paper. That would give it more drag as well. Just sticking it back together quickly. Maybe even these thicker ones here. Doesn't fall apart too much. I feel like I need a one right here. We're just going to begin sticking this together and reducing it. Not really reducing it, but trying to, like, if you had holes in this, you know how to do, most of you know how to do makume gane, and if you don't, go look up makume gane on the internet. But if you were to push holes in this, it would have empty spaces, so you have to get them all pushed together. Basically, because I don't have any, like, big indents, I just want to get it all in one solid block so when I cut it, it won't fall apart. Mainly. So I'm just gonna kind of condense it all together again. Make sure it's one solid sheet. You could use your roller just a hair, you know, like this. But I had a nice small thick block to begin with, so it's easier. You don't have to do as much of this. It's easier to slice when you have a nice thicker block. So pretty much we just distorted all those lines in there. Make sure it's together, because when you start slicing this, you don't want to have an issue with it falling apart on you, which it does sometimes happen. And if it does, it's not the end of the world. So now that it's together, we're going to cut in the same direction as we just did, not down like this. See, if you cut down like this, you're just going to see the lines. Okay? We want to cut into it the same way up it just was when we were putting in our pattern. Okay? So with the lines, not against the lines, with the grain, like this. Okay, and each layer is going to look a little different. If you cut them all evenly, it's going to do one thing. If you gouge into it, it's going to do another thing. This one I gouged into a little bit. Can you see that? So this, then you put together to make a veneer. I'm just cutting a bunch of slices to see which ones I like the best until I get a few that I really like. Here we go. These are the ones I kind of wanted a little chunkier, so maybe I should have left my layers a little thicker, because I do tend to go for the chunkier patterns in everything. Even like when I was coloring, I liked coloring the ones that had thick lines. And this right here is where my layers weren't all perfectly cut and square. See, I got some of the end on it. That's fine. To me, that adds a little interest. But if you want it all perfect, definitely cut any raggedy ends off. These last ones get harder to cut. It's really hard to cut it. It's thin like that. Being careful. Yes, people. If I cut myself, I cut myself. I will not die from a blade cut. Well, on my fingertip. Okay. So now we just pick some that we like. And it's like, do I want to keep the striped lines? Do I want to get rid of the striped lines? I'm thinking I might get rid of them. So what I'm going to do is mix up all these scraps and make something that I can lay this on. See, that's one side's busier than the other. That's the end. I got a few there. Let me mix up these scraps. And I'll be right back. So another thing as you're mixing up scraps is you can see as you're stretching it out if you're going to want to stretch your pattern out too. Okay? So to see if that's more of what you want. So always keep your eye out when you're mixing things if like you like that better or if you like that better. Okay? So just be looking. Always be looking. So I have my scrap laid out on a, just rolled out on a thinner setting. A 3. I'm just going to stick it on a separate tile just because it's easier for me to work. And if I don't finish this project tonight, I can just set it off to the side. And then all I'm going to do is take pieces that I like and lay them on. And we're going to make a veneer. This pendant's going to have a multi-part. It's going to be multi-parted. So this will be just one part. Now this one's really thick compared to my other one. So I might have to shave that one off a little bit. I like that one. I like that side. And it's okay if they're not all perfectly even. We're going to be burnishing them out. This was the bottom layer because it has such... I shaved some of it off to get some more scrap. I still feel like it's too thick. I like this one, but it's really thin. So do I have a thin piece I don't like as much? I like parts of this, but I don't like all of it. And because we use the base tone that's very similar, that comes from this color, if we have little gaps, it won't really matter. It'll all blend in once we burnish it. So you're just gonna lay them all on here till you're happy. And once they're all laid on, if you have little gaps, you can fill those in. Just take one of your pieces and grab a part of it. That's the whole fun thing about it, is it doesn't need to be perfectly matched up. It's Makume Gane. I probably shouldn't use the end because it has the end design. It's not, and well, at least mine in this one isn't an exact pattern. So you can really just kind of go for it and have a good old time just seeing what comes out. So right here on this seam, I'm just going to add a piece. That part's a little thinner right there, so I'll add a little bit more in there. Okay, and then we'll grab a piece of parchment, something. Now this parchment is old. That's junk. Here's a piece, but pretty wrinkled. That's okay. Because I'm going to stretch it out. I'm going to roll it through my pasta machine. Which is why I told you guys to keep an eye out for that, because I like bigger, chunkier patterns. I just always have. So I'm going to burnish this first. And then I'm going to run it through my pasta machine and stretch it a little bit if I can. So I'm really putting some pressure. This is not a thing where you are going to stress out if your burnish isn't perfect or if your seams are perfect. And a lot of time when I'm burnishing, I'm being very careful that I'm not like pushing clay onto another side. But in this case, it's okay because it's not an exact pattern. Good. So now that it's all on there, how thick is this feeling? So if the background clay is a setting 3, and my top clay is just a, I have no clue what I'm going to roll it just a hair. I don't want to stretch it too much on setting 0. I want to be able to control the stretch. So if it's way thicker than my thickest setting on my pasta machine, it's really going to stretch heavy. I can always go down thinner, but I want to be able to control how much it stretches. So I'm going to get it at least to a 0, and then I can take it down from there. Okay, so I'm going to roll this through at a 0 in one direction. Doesn't really matter which. I should probably just get these ends cut off. And I'm only making one pendant, so I don't need a mass amount. I never make a mass amount of things because I only sell what people have commented on and liked, but I don't really do polymer clay to sell. I do it to enjoy. Because for me, selling things makes it too stressful that I don't enjoy doing it. So that's running it through from here up, and now I'm going to flip it, go down a size in the other direction. I'm going to keep going until I like it. I really like this part here. I really like this part here. I put it in, I caught diagonally, so it kind of stretched a little bit more. Maybe I'm going to go down one more. Do I want to go down width-wise or length-wise? Let's go to width. Setting 4. I'm down to a 4 now. See, I like it how it's stretching out the pattern to get a little chunkier. I really like this part up here. And right here, and right here. So I definitely have enough for many pendants on this. So there's part one. So let me mix all this up, get it put away, and I'll get colors for my part two. Okay guys, this video is getting weird because I made something which I'm going to show you because I explained it a little further later, but I made a makume gane to go with the first veneer, right? I made one to go with this and I did not like it, but I need to show you how I got the colors to make this. Okay, so, and I'm going to show you how to do this. I just need to show you how I got the colors. Okay, so first thing, we have some Kato orange, or orange, any orange. I just had Kato nearby, so I grabbed it. Okay, what I did was I took some Kato orange, and you know the browns we started to make the veneer with, the first veneer, I had the pure dark color, and then I gradually mixed it with white. This is the lightest bit. So I mixed a little of this in here, and then I added some white, and it came out with a color roughly like that. And I made three tones. I added, just like we did with the gray, I did it with the orange. So the orange and the gray, the lightest gray tone you have, and then make that lighter, make three different tones of oranges, okay? And we're gonna use that next in the extruder. So it's gonna be a little weird, but for a second, because I cut out a part that really did not look great, and I changed my mind. So that's it. Okay, so I took every single one of our colors that we've used, the two browns, because what I had left, so a lighter one, and the darker one. And then I had some of the three oranges left, and I'm gonna use those plus some white. And I just cut out random circles and about the same size as my extruder. And we're just gonna begin making a stack. I also have my square die that I'm gonna use for my extruder. I think that's the one I'll use. And we'll see what we're gonna get with this. I don't know if I'm gonna use every one of these colors or as much as I have. Because right now I have a lot more of this and a lot more of this than any other color. So we'll kind of see. So I think I want the dark first on the bottom, because they're all going to get pushed through that. So that should be the coating. And I think maybe let's do a... It doesn't really, really matter. I don't even know what the hell I'm doing. I don't even know why I'm explaining. Just stick them together. Hopefully this should bring the two pieces together. It might not. I want this one going towards the die first, because I do want it all coated in the dark. There we go. And let's see what we get. And the stiffer your clay is, the harder it's going to be to squish out. So because the dark was first, it was pushing everything through the dark. And remember, I'm in mid-February. It was Valentine's on Friday. So, you know, I'm kind of in dark mode right now. It's Vermont, which is way up north. So I'm not in springy type colors or anything like that. So I'm trying to find stuff that will go with my outfit. So let's cut these in smallish sections, because my pendant doesn't need to be that thick. They look like chalk right now. And then you don't want to put the ones right next to each other, So let's see, how many do I got? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Oh, that's good. I can do 4 and 4. But I don't think I want to stack them, actually. I think I just want to do a one row. I'm just looking at them so I can see. I'm making sure I'm not sticking the same with the same. See, because that one's very similar to that one. I wouldn't want to stick them next to each other. It's the end, so it got an air bubble in it. That one's very similar to that one, but this end's not. But I already have a white in the center there, so what if I put that one there? And this, my goal would be to use this, just gently rolling in between those two. In between those two veneers we just made. Like that. Like that. And then I was also going to put a little white strip too. Maybe we'll do something like that. Hey, I don't know. Ready, we'll start putting this bad boy together. Okay, so we made this veneer. And then I made another Makume Gane that I do not like with this veneer. They're just way too busy. So we're going to scrap this part here, and I just deleted it from the video, okay? So if the video is a little weird, I cut a part out. The way you get these colors, though, is I took orange. This is Kato, okay? And these were the two, this was the first color we started, and then we made lighters. So I took this, a little bit of this, and mixed it with the orange to get this dark orange, okay? Then I added some white to get a medium tone and some white to get a lighter tone. So I have three tones of this orange mixed with this dusty brown and a little white to get it lighter and lighter and lighter, okay? That's all you really need to know. But pick whatever colors you want. You don't have to pick the same colors I'm doing. Okay, so that's where we get this color here. This is the light one, okay? So the orange and this grayish color mixed together with a bunch of white. Now, one part of the video that I am going to keep is the extruder. We made this with the three oranges. I took circles of all three colors, the dark, medium, and light. And then the two browns that I had, or grays, I took circles out of them, and white, which is in the video, and we made this. This part I will include in the video. You probably, once I set this video up, have already seen it. Now, I need to get another part for the pendant. I have this part I'm going to use. I have this part, but I need something else. So I took, this is on a setting 5 right now. It's pretty thin. And if we're going to make a multi-part pendant, we want everything on the same setting. So this one here is that orange on a setting 6, because I'm going to put something on top of it. Do you remember in a pendant tutorial we made last week or the week before? I don't know which order it's going to be in. This one here with this orange. I have that scrap right here. I'm going to use this scrap because I think that will be give me what I want. So this right now is on a 4. This is on a 6. And I hope when I put them together, I won't have to stretch this out too much. And I'll run it through the pasta machine and I'll put it on a setting 5. So I'm just going to lay this from the other week's pendant tutorial, the scrap. So this is translucent and I'm just backing it with a light pinky color. I'm just going to set it on there. And then I'm going to run it through my pasta machine on a setting 5, and that way both parts of my veneer are the same. Okay, now it's on a setting 5. Done. And this is on a setting 5. Is it? Wow, that feels thicker than this one. No, they should be the same thickness. Is this on a 5 or a 4? They should be about the same thickness, actually. Okay. So now we have all three parts of our pendant material that we're going to need. I know that might be a little confusing. You saw every part you need to make it, except for the mixing of the color of the orange. So let's cut this out. So if you didn't watch that video, definitely check it out. So this is translucent to get this glittery one. This is translucent mixed with alcohol inks and metal leaf. And that's what gave me this. And then I just mixed it up. And I told you in that video to keep those scraps because they do work out quite well. Okay. So we have that piece. Now I need to pick a part of this that I like. And I do like right here a lot, down here. So I think that's the part I'm going to use. And it's just easier if you have all of these on separate tiles. It really is. So I just bought my tiles on Amazon. But then I can move them out of the way and set them aside. And I do my makeup right here in the morning so I can lay my makeup out and then not have... I can just move these all out of my way. Okay, so we have two parts for the pendant. And I also want to add another part here. Let me just cut this scrap end off. And I actually think I just want to use this part down here. I don't know if that's something in it. Hang on. Yep, there was something in that. So I think I'm going to cut this like this, actually. Set that one aside. I think I'm going to use that part. Now, we need to run out one of these, or cut one of these, and I need to try to cut it to the same thickness as that veneer is. So, if I can do it without my Lucy clay slicer, I'm going to try. First, I'm going to cut one off just to get, hopefully, an even. That's not too bad there. And then I'm going to cut one. Actually, I like that one, though. Let's cut another one just to see. Thin. I can go a little thicker. Yep, that's about the right thickness. I'm just going to push it together. Oh, you know what I was going to do? I wasn't going to do this. I was going to put some white in between all of this, so hang on. I'm just gonna put a little layer of white. White. Okay, let me get some white rolled out. Again, on a setting 5. Okay, I got my white out. Get another tile out here. Now, I was gonna put this on a backing because this is very thin, so I should. You know what? Maybe I'll just use this weird looking back as a backing. Why not? It's a piece of clay. Let's lay all of this on this. I'm going to lay it flat on my tile because I'm going to then put everything on this. Let's do that. Okay, let's put this on. This edge straight again. It's hard to put multi-part pendants together. This is two parts is one thing, but doing 3 or 4 or 5 parts, which is what we're gonna do, is kind of hard. So I want a straight edge and try to pick it up without distorting it. Let's lay it on here. This edge looks high. My fiance's podcast is so freaking loud. He's in the shower. He listens to Joe Rogan podcasts, which are actually really good. I end up getting into listening to them. Okay, and then I was going to take a layer of white. Now, I need 2 thin white strips, which is tough to get them the same thickness. Again, everything's on a setting 5 right now. Maybe I can try to ruler it. that'd be too hard. Let me just eyeball it. Okay. I'm gonna move it in front of me. Let me just cut a couple and see how even I can get them. Stick to my blade. And I'm using the back side of my blade just to kind of make sure everything's butted up. Like that. Okay. We're gonna burnish this in a minute. And then I want to take that strip that I had. Was it this one? Lay that on. See what end is the flattest, because that's the one I want to put against it, and then the other end I can bump it up with the blade. Again, blunt end of my blade. I'm just going to butt those up against each other as much as I can. And then I'm going to take that other white strip. See if I can pick it up with my blade at all. It helps. You can get it to stick to your blade. And then we'll butt that up against this. And I'm going to try to make a couple more of these just to see what I get. Take a piece of this orange and we'll put that on the top. Now I'm using this cutter, so let me just see how thick of a piece I need. Actually, it doesn't need to be that thick. Okay. See, what's nice is I can just move all of these out of my way. Especially when I'm on camera and I only have a little area to record in. Just with my fingers, I'm just trying to butt it up against each other and keep it as straight as I possibly can. And then I'm going to get a piece of paper. You want to be careful with this because you don't want to try to not distort your lines. So go with your lines at first and go gently at first. Really go gently. Luckily, we have this on a backing. So yes, burnishing it will get rid of every single seam, but you don't need to because we're going to resin it and sand it. And so the backing's really going to hold it down level or hold it as one piece. I think mainly I just want to get it to look like it's closed. There's not really any gaps between any of the layers. Thank you. You know, I mean, these squares, they're squares, so you might get a little gapping, but there's orange way back there, so it's okay. I'm gonna get my fingerprints off, and then we'll cut our shape, and then I'll probably make another one or two of them, maybe one more. I like to make two, and that way I have two to pick from, and that way if I screw up on resining one of them or anything, I have a backup before I scrap all of this clay, right? And so I think I was going to do hard thing is these squares aren't centered. Do I want more of the brown? Do I want more of the orange? Do I want even? You know, do I want it like that? Like that. I could hang it like that. Maybe I'll do one like this and one the other way. You know, but again, you could do like that. You know, whatever you want. You might do it like this. And drill a hole up here, and then I might do another one the regular way. Make sure it's really cut out before I mess with it. It's not pure white, but it's scrap white that I keep when I just need to tint something. Nah, that one got orange on it. I don't need pure white, but just need a tint of color. That's good white for that. I'm trying to pull up as much of this scrap as I possibly can before I take my cutter off, if I can help it. Like that. And I'm not going to mess with the edges. I will trim the edges with my Dremel later. It's not too bad, right? That'll be a good winter pendant. I have like this dusty pink sweater that I've been wearing, and I need something to go with it. And I don't really have anything. I mean, I'm just wearing it under my scrub shirt or under my lab coat at work, but it's still, I don't really have anything to go with it. So I'm trying to make something to go with it. So I think I'm going to make one more, which means I need some more backing. So maybe I'll show you one more. Maybe I'll show you in a fast-forwarded version. That's way you can see me do it again now that I have some practice. So I just took those scrap strips that I had just cut off that cane that were too thin that we just cut off of here, and I just laid them on that scrap orange, and that's what I'm going to use for the backing side. So it's not anything pretty, but whatever, it's just a backing, right? So here we go, I'll do it fast forwarded. So the reason why I was pulling all of this stuff apart was, again, to keep the white, if it's pretty clean white, to tint things, though it's not pure white. Hey, that might lighten a color there. This stuff I'm mixing all in one, right? But this is glitter, and I don't, well, not really glitter, but it has the metal leaf in it, and I don't want to mix all of this and have metal leaf in all of this. So that's why I was trying to pull the metal leaf ones off, because I don't want it mixed in. So what we have now are these two. Let me just pull this big hunk off, but I'm not worried because, again, with my Dremel, I can buff this easy, easy. So these are the two we have. So I'm going to bake them off. The second one I just did was the center strip is a little higher, but when I sand that, that will be fine because this is all clay, so this is can be fully sanded. So I'm going to bake them. Because I'm doing one bake, I'm going to bake 275 for a full hour. Someone asked me the other day, how do you bake Fimo and Cernit and Kato and everything at the same temperature when I was mixing two different brands? I bake everything at 275. I have tested it in my oven, so I know it works fine in my oven. Because some of them bake, what, 235 or something? It's a lower temperature than the Primo. What is Fimo? Right here, I have a pack in front of me. Where is it? Let me see if I can find it right here. Do you have to flip this thing over? 130 degrees Celsius. What's 130 degrees Celsius? Yeah, 130. So Fimo soft and Primo are both 130 degrees Celsius or 275. I think Cernit, I got a Cernit pack here. Let's check. Cernit ,110 to 130 degrees Celsius, 230 to 265. So, I mean, it's only slightly cooler. So I bake at 275, but I would test that when I'm mixing my clays. I do it, and I do it for a full hour no matter what. So that's what I'm going to do. I think the only thing in here is a little, this orange came from the Kato mixed with Primo. So, you know, it's like 50-50 Kato orange and then Primo, this scrap brown that I had. And then some Primo white. So mainly it's Primo. So anyways, I'm going to get these baked. And when that's done, I will be back. So here they are, both out of the oven. And we're ready to sand them off and make them a little more level. So when it comes to sanding, you can sand two different ways. And I know I've said this many times. You can just get plain wet dry sandpaper and sand it by hand. And that works totally fine. Or what I just found for myself was a electric sander. And this is a skill sander. It's got a triangle loop and hook closure, which is like this Velcro. And so you get pads. Now this sander is on my Amazon account. The pads that come with this sander are only a few grit. So I have a second pad set that I had to get that have a few more grits, but you can get like round ones. These are really fine grits. This is like 1500, 2000, 2500, 3000. So you can get these ones. These fit on here too. They're just round because I couldn't find any for this type. These are just round. So these fit as well. The only one I don't have that I'm going to order is a 600 grit. So that one I still have to do by hand. So when you're using this guy, it just literally Velcros on. And you can see I use the fine point more up here. So all I do over time is just, as it gets beaten up, I just rotate it. And kind of spin it around. So I'm using different parts of the pad. You're still going to wet dry sand this. But what's nice is this one has a filtration device too. Someone on my Facebook page said she got one and she was making a big vase and she actually really liked it. So I'm happy it worked out for at least one person I know of. But again, you can sand the old-fashioned way, and I'll show you both quickly. So I do have a bowl of water. This is my sanding bowl on the side, and an old rag as well. So pretty much I just dip them in the water, I'm going to turn this on. It can get kind of loud. So, you know, if you're in a small apartment building, probably not the best thing, but it's not crazy loud. It's going to seem loud because it's maybe a hand width away from my camera. So it's going to seem more loud than it actually is when you're just working it. But anyways, it makes sanding so much faster. How long do you sand for? I have no clue. Until it feels good to your fingers. You know, so now that's fairly flush, whereas before, because I'm not great at cutting everything perfect, there's like lips, whereas now this one is flush. Okay, so just sand until it feels good. Your lower grits, like your 400, is going to be more for removing any lumps and bumps. And that's really going to depend on how well and how smooth it was before you baked it. Your higher grits are just getting rid of the roughness that you created from your lower grits, okay? And because I use resin, it's going to hide in a lot of it. So lately, I've only been sanding about up to 1,000. So I'm going to finish this one until I get to the 600 grit. And then I'll show you how I do that one by hand. You know, and how I sand these really just depends on my mood. If I just feel like doing it by hand or if I feel like doing it by a machine. So, you know, if my nails are done, I tend not to want to do it like this because I might get my nails. So I tend to use the machine. So pretty much the grits I always use when I'm resining is 400, 600, 800, 1000, 1500, and then I use my Dremel to buff. If you're not resining, you may want to go all the way up to 10,000. You know, you go up to 1000, 1500, I think it's 2000, 2500, 3000, 3500, 4000, 4500, 5000, and I think it jumps to 7, 8, 9, 10. So you can get really fine grits to get a nice high shine if you're not using a Dremel or resin, if that's the look you're going for. So it really just depends on the look you want and what you want to achieve and whatever. So, but some people go, why do you sand and buff before you resin? I figure if it looks better before I resin, it's going to look better after I resin. Resin is a magnifying glass. It can hide some indents because it's creating a smooth surface, but it can't hide every imperfection. So, you know, definitely try to get rid of as many as you can, you know, and use your fingers. Your fingers are a great tool to tell you if things are smooth enough. So if it feels smoother after you're done sanding than before you started, then it's probably done. This is all I would do, all the way up through the grits. This makes my shoulder hurt, which is why I like the machine. And if you make a lot of bowls and vases and stuff like that, this little mouse skill sander, this little with the triangle, actually works fairly well. I used them on those faux burlwood bowls a lot, actually, because that's what got me thinking about buying this sander, is when I made those bowls, it took a lot of sanding to get them to the high shine I wanted, especially since I wasn't resining them. And doing it by hand, I mean, made my hand and my arm throb. So I just found it was easier. I also had, some people use like this foot polisher sander thing. Day or Kaliana uses that. I do have that and that works well, but when I was looking to take off, I needed some more oomph, you know? And so this one has that oomph because it's made for like woodworking and stuff. But it's small enough to be able to handle. No, it's not too, too big. It's small enough to be able to handle and you just kind of glide it around. So I really like that machine. Actually, I use it most times when I'm sanding. It's so much faster than this. This is just one grit. This is just 600 grit. It's so, this takes forever because it's vibrating at such a high speed. It's doing 10 times the amount I can do. So you can hold it up like this or you can put it down and do it like this, but I don't want to sand my nails off. Do I get a piece of glitter in that? Isn't that funny? Do you see it down in there? Depending what angle I turn it at. It's kind of funny, huh? Okay, it's feeling pretty good. Okay, I'm going to keep moving on up till probably about 1,000, maybe 1,500. Probably about 1,000. They're already pretty smooth. So I finished sanding, and this is what it looks like sanded right over here. So what I'm going to do is I can show you the difference between sanding and buffing and the two wheels I have. So I have an orange and white wheel set. Separately, I have bought different white ones, but I didn't feel like it was doing enough. So I got this orange and white wheel set. Now, everything that I recommend on my Amazon is something I have tried. Now, if you go out and try to find a different brand of these and they fray all over, it may be because it's a different brand. The ones I have don't fray after the first time. They don't spit things out. The first time they spit a couple, but I've used maybe two of these in a year. And this one's getting pretty beat. When you first open it, they're a lot tighter. And both of them only frayed, and I have a big bag of them. So if you buy different brands, that's fine. Just make sure, you know, if it frays, be willing to know that, that it may not be what I'm showing you. So anyways, beyond that. So what I did here was I sanded right here. This one I buffed with the orange wheel and this one I buffed with the orange and then the white. Now the orange wheel is a little more coarse than the white one, so it will get down any fine grooves that you still have in your sanding. The white then gives it a really high shine. So let me see if I can get it to tilt at the same speed in the light. See how much smoother that is when you do sanding, orange, orange and white. It just gives it such a high shine. And people that have used both of them have said they noticed a difference as well. So pretty easy to do. Also, you don't want to be at the highest speed. That's why I don't like the Dremels that only have a high low, because the high is really high and the low is really low. So, you know, when I'm doing this, it goes from 5 to 35. And I generally use it at a 15 when I'm buffing. So the way you use this one, you hit your lock button to unlock and unscrew, slide yours in, and keep your finger down on your lock button and tighten it. Give it a pull, make sure it's on there. And then with gentle pressure, you're not pushing. If you're pushing, you're going to trim, okay? With gentle pressure, you're just going to go over it. That's funny that I have a piece of glitter in there, or the metal flake. You're just going to go over it. Sometimes I do circles, later I'll go back and forth, but very, very light pressure. I'm just kind of gliding it along. Oops. And on camera I'm going to fling it a bunch. Until you start to get a nice high shine. And these ones are getting pretty worn out because, like I said, I've only used two of these in a year. And This one I've been using since the beginning of November. So it is getting pretty deep. So I should take out a couple more. But you get a big bag for like 14 bucks or something. It's not like there's... I try to put... The stuff on my Amazon that I put on my Amazon is stuff that I've purchased and I feel like is reasonable. You know, stuff like your pasta machine and your pasta machine motor. Yeah, it's going to be more expensive. But I don't have all the money in the world to buy products, so it's usually not too expensive. And if I don't think it's good, I won't put it on there. If I've used it and it works well for me, well, that's what I'll put on there. And it's just so you guys have links to it. Now, you can buy them from different companies, but I have Amazon Prime, so I try to go with Amazon because I can get it in 2 days. Also, the other thing is, because I'm an Amazon ambassador, if you do buy something from me, rather than supporting me in like a patron account, and you have to pay to see my videos, you pay me $5 a month or up to $15 a month, some people do. I've even seen higher than $15 a month, I think. So rather than you paying for the videos, if you support me or pay for something on my Patreon account, I make like cents on the dollar, or on my Amazon account, I make like cents on a dollar for recommending a product. So maybe I make $20 or $30 a month. Well, for me, I can use that in buying clay, or I can use that in buying different products to maybe show you for different projects. So it does help me buy more stuff for you guys. So all I would do is just maybe a little bit more on the orange because I can see from one side to the other. This side's a little more dull. And then I'll do the same exact thing with the white until I get it to a nice high shine. Okay. And front and back as well. So I already did this one with both wheels. This one I haven't done at all. This one's just sanded. Big difference. And I only sanded up to about 1,000. So it's smooth to the touch, but it's not glossy. But my Dremel will get it glossy. The other thing I forgot to say I do with my Dremel, I'm going to bring you over my lap. I know I've showed you this before, is I trim my edges by choking up on it and going towards me. Now, I do tend to bevel the back edge in, so I tend to tilt my wheel like this. So when you're looking straight on, you don't see the back edge. Now, I've already sanded the edges, but you can kind of see the back edge over here a little bit. So what I'll do is I'll grab it and I'll bevel like this. Just light, a little more pressure than you would do with your buffing. Like that. And just, that will get off any of your scraggly bits. But you can do it when you're sanding too. But if you ever want to refine an edge, oh, there goes a piece. If you ever want to refine an edge, you can do it with your Dremel, with just a little bit of pressure. You know, be conservative. You can always do more pressure, but you don't want to go crazy with something until you know what it's going to do, and that takes practice. If anything, bake off some scrap clay into little squares or rounds or whatever you want to do, and practice. I don't know why people think they can't practice. You don't even know how many times a day someone posts something like, oh, my resin didn't work, or this didn't work, or that didn't work. Well, unfortunately, a lot of things take practice, especially resin. So why are you putting it on for your first time ever, if you're trying a new brand, why are you putting it on a piece that you like and that you worked really hard on? Why aren't you just baking a piece of scrap and practicing on that? Why? What's the difference? Why can't you do that? You can. So just bake a piece of scraps clay. It only needs to be this big. And practice with your resin a few times, especially if you're trying a new brand. See how long it takes you to cure. See how sticky that inhibition layer gets, which is the layer of uncured resin. Some of them get that sticky. It's not really sticky resin, but it's like greasy. You know, see how hard it is to get rid of air bubbles. And if you have to, you know, use a torch or use a hairdryer or use a heat gun. You know, you got to play with all of those things, and different clays will play. See how much it pulls away. So if I do a thin layer, it pulls away less. If I do a thick layer, it's going to pull away more from the edge. If I do two layers, I can fix that. I might have to do three. You know, play. practice, but don't use pieces that you're in love with. Use junk, scrap pieces, or pieces that you've made and go, don't like that. I keep those in a box. I have so many pieces in a box. Stuff I made and wasn't in love with, just like tester stuff, stuff like that. You know, some of these aren't bad. These, like, that's not bad. But I made these the other day and I wasn't in love with them. Those are going to stay in my scrap box. This one, this scrap one, I could finish this one. I do have a box of ones that I do like and ones that I don't like. And I just emptied. So here's a bunch of them that didn't quite work out. This resin I got messed up right down here. You know, this thing here, I have no clue. This thing. So there's a lot of them in here that I don't like, that I'm never ever going to wear. But they're good tester pieces. Oh, this is Sculpey 3. That's the difference between Sculpey 3. This should be Primo. And Primo. It should bend. Sculpey 3. Boop. Breaks. Sculpey 3 sucks. It really does. This is Primo. Again, baked correctly, should be flexible. Not just shattering your fingers. Sculpey 3 literally almost turned me off with polymer clay. Literally almost turned me off with polymer clay. So, keep your junk pieces. Okay, I'm going to finish these up. I will finish buffing all the way, and I will get them resined. And then we'll drill a hole, and we'll be done. I really like the way they're turning out. This one I'll probably hang like this. And this one I'll probably hang with the brown down. Or the grayish brown down. Okay, let me finish. So I've resined them, and here they are. And we'll drill some holes and finish them off. And since I haven't drilled any holes in the last few videos, I will drill it now in this one. So with these square shapes, I have a hard time, if I'm leaving it square, finding where the center is. So that way, I definitely use a permanent marker. I just find that's my easiest way to determine where the center is. Now I need to figure out, am I going to hang it like this? No, I like it top to bottom. I think I do like this grayish brown on the bottom. So let's try to find the center. Somewhere around there, I think, would be fine. And then on this one, I am going to hang like this. And again, I think I want the orange at the top. So that one should be fairly easy. And it doesn't need to be exactly where you're going to drill the hole. It can be down from it or up from it. But as long as it's, you can put it in line with it, you should be fine. So again, I've showed you again many, many times my pin drill. This one I got on Amazon. It's on my Amazon Ambassador. The base twist, so you can just put it in your palm and twist your fingers and you don't have to twist your whole hands. You open and close, loosen and tighten this, and that will open and close the chuck. I always start with my smallest bit first, and that way I have less risk of cracking my resin or my clay. The stronger the clay you use, the stronger the resin you use, the better chances of not cracking. But I use cheap resin most of the time. So then just put it wherever you want it. These aren't that thick, but I like to go as close to the edge as possible. The closer to the edge you go, the more risk of cracking. So I just put it down. I know you couldn't see that, but then I make a tick mark in the clay. And that way you can kind of, again, look at it and go, okay. But I would be pretty sure, because once you put that tick mark, it's always going to be there. So if it's in the wrong spot, you know, that's why the permanent marker is so handy. If you're not good at finding your center, all you got to do is wipe it off with a little alcohol. That's it. Super handy. Some of these little ones are getting pretty worn down. I did order another kit on Amazon that has refills for the pin drills. I think I put that on my Amazon Ambassador page, because these small ones break too when you're pushing on them. It's easier if it's on the table because I can put pressure against the back without worrying about sticking my finger. There we go. But the container with the extra tips fell behind my stand and I can't get it out myself. Look, you see that? So the other day I was talking to my doctor at work and her and I kind of were just talking, and I guess I use my hands a lot when I talk. And so her and I were talking and her thumbnail stabbed me. And I immediately peroxided it and everything, but it still got all red. It's almost healed now. Pretty healed. I could just see it on camera. It looks really, really red. I've been wearing band-aids on it at work. So be careful if you're pushing back with your fingers, because once that comes through the backside, it's going to hurt you. But I do generally put it down on the table like this because I can put more pressure without worrying about my finger being behind there. And once you get the first one through, like I said, I think these bits are getting worn because I find lately I've had a harder time getting this first one through. It takes a second longer. It's almost through though. I can feel it. There it is. And go through both sides just to clean it up. And, you know, you can back them with whatever you want. I just back them so these three parts had a little more support, but I don't care what the back looks like. This was that veneer that I made and I deleted because I didn't think it went well with this. And this is just the scraps that I showed you. This was just a Makume Gane veneer I made. But it didn't, it was too busy with this Makume Gane to put it all together. So I think this metal leaf inside this orangey color worked better. I haven't made one like this with the extruder. Once you get the first hole, it's pretty easy to go up through the other sizes. And this one's nice because that's all you have to do to change a tip. I've seen others where people have to unscrew this whole sheathing thing, take the sheathing off, put your tip in, put your sheathing back on, screw your sheathing back on, unscrew it, put the... This one you don't have to. You just open the little thing, pull your bit out, put your new bit in. So I like this pin drill. Almost done. I got one more size to go. And you can make your holes whatever sizes you want. It just really depends on the gauge of your wire for your jump rings. But I do like my jump rings to move a little bit. So that way my pendant does have a little swing to it. Some of them are stiffer. I've had some where I've done a small hole and it was stiff on the jump ring, but it's nice if it can swing a little bit. I want to wear one of these tomorrow. Okay, holes are drilled. So now we need to put a jump ring and a bail on. And I can, because they're not that thick, I think I can get away with a 6mm around jump ring. But I have my 7s close by. And really, I need to figure out what color. Initially, I always wear silver. 9 times out of 10, you know, my ring's silver, all my necklaces are silver. I only have like one set of gold earrings, and they're like ones from like a Kohl's or a department store, and they're like Christmas or snowflakes, so they're like little crappy little earrings. So when I feel it, when I get a gold bail, I feel like I have to wear gold. And I hate one thing. I hate how resin dulls the white down. It always does. And I've tested different resins to see if some are more yellowy than others, and they're all pretty about equal. Let me grab my thingy. Hang on. So I tested all my resins to see if any are like yellower than others. So, and I put some permanent marker to see. So this is Elisa Pavelka. This is a Decor Rom, RJ Crafts. This is that, which is these two, the Decor Rom and this QIAO, QIAO, are like, honestly, I think they're the same resin, just in a different box or a different bottle. They're both on Amazon. They're both about the same price, but I literally think they're the same freaking resin, both of these. And then I also did the Tiny Pandora one here. So they all dull the white. You know, it's definitely not as vibrant, but they're all about equal. So not any of those is yellower than the other, just so you know. Or from what I found. So my question is, do I use silver? You know, will silver look good with it? Or do I gotta use, like, because this is, it's silver leaf, but because we put alcohol ink on it, it looks more goldy, depending. So do I gotta use a gold tone? You know, that's my question, is like, do I kind of, I mean, I can use whatever I want, but my mind goes more towards, my eye, I get drawn more towards silver. I'm going with silver. Now I gotta figure out which one. I like these little ones. I got these on Amazon, and they're on my ambassador page. These are tiny little ones, and I like these if I want a really nondescript. You know, obviously we have bigger ones that are much bigger if you want, you know, your thing to be showing. I also got these on Amazon, all of these. I just have them sorted out, and I like the shape. Sometimes this shape is nice. Like when you make like a teardrop pendant or something, you would think, oh, go with a teardrop veil, but I kind of like the contrast of the round when I'm doing that kind of shape. For some reason, I like it better. So I got those on Amazon, and I use them actually quite a bit. That goes in the wrong one. They have different patterns on them, so I have them sorted per pattern. No, that one's too dark. That one's a silver with like a tarnish in it. These I got from Etsy, from Litha, L-Y-T-H-A, Studios with an S. Or it could be Litha, or I have no clue how you say your name. I know Fire Mountain Gems probably sells them too, but it's easier for me just to click on Etsy or Amazon. Yeah, that's way too big. I hate deciding what bale to use. That's like the worst. Maybe I'll just do this tiny one. Honestly, that's like the worst part for me. Yeah, I think I'm going to go with this small one for both of them. Which one will I wear? That's my other thought. Because I'm probably only going to finish off one, because I'm not going to wear two of the same pattern. So do I want to wear that one? Or do I want to wear that one? Let me think about this. Hang on. I'm going to go with the square one. Like the square shape. They're both square. I mean, they're the same shape, but just one's angled differently. And then I'll keep this one in my box if finished. If one of my friends likes it or something, I can give that to someone. And then I have a 6mm jump ring. I have my Beadalon pliers that I've showed you guys before that I really like because they're nice and small, good grip. They're little small handles here. They're not big fat ones. You know, here they're not super fat. And they, when it's fully extended, it's not like I have to grab it. It's nice little. I like these ones a lot, actually. That's why I bought two of them. Well, I bought one, and then I liked it so much I found it on Amazon. So I'm about an hour away from the closest art store. So Amazon, because I'm an ambassador, or not an ambassador, a Prime member, I can get things in like a day or two. Whereas, yes, you can order a lot of things on Etsy, but you're talking a week. Same with, you know, other sites, which is why I tend to use... I was just wiping off that permanent marker that I had on it. There was still a little bit on it with some. I don't use 99% alcohol once I've resined. I only use the regular isopropyl that you would buy for like a wound, you know, at the store. Mine's 70%. So anyways, when you grab your jump ring to open it, you're twisting front to back, okay? One plier towards you, one plier away from you. You're not pulling side to side. Okay, and then just slide it in. Let's see if that's fat enough around to get in there. A little fidgeting. Good. Okay. Slide my bale on. Grab one end. And once you get the bale on, it can get a little harder to get a good grip on it. And then twist front to back again. Sometimes one side's higher than the other, so sometimes you gotta give it a little pinch down. Mine's actually pretty good. You can twist this around so you don't see the seam, but over time it's just gonna spin back around. Let me grab my stand with my little necklace holder and we'll look at it on a black background. So there it is. I think it's really pretty on a basic leather cord. That's where I wear them on. Well, that's what I wear them on, so I can change them out every single day. I mean, you can wear them on a silver chain or whatever, too. This is that one that right there, there's a piece of glitter in it. Can you see it right above my finger? Which is kind of funny that somehow I got a piece of glitter in it. Or it might be metal leaf. I have no clue. But oh well. So I really like this one. After having a couple pendants I wasn't super thrilled with, I actually have one I like. Maybe it's because there's brighter colors. I'm still in winter mode. You know, it's second to last week of February, and it's just gray and cold here. And I think I need spring. I'm ready for spring so I can start doing color. Because if you wear a bright color right now, it really just doesn't match the time of year and the clothing that you're wearing. You know, we're all in big winter coats and sweaters and long johns and knee-high socks and boots and gloves and hats and mittens and scarves every time you walk out of the house. So anyways, that's it. I hope you guys liked this one. I hope it gave you some ideas, and I will see you next time. Later.